Okay, good morning to all. Today we are going to start cardiovascular regulatory system, okay, mechanisms. Now, in the previous lectures, we saw that the blood flow needs to be maintained and the cardiac output is equal to the sum of the blood flow requirements of all the tissues coming together. Okay, so why is this blood flow regulation very important? The blood flow regulation is very important first so that the redistribution of the blood can be done to the active tissues. Okay, in the same amount of cardiac output, the redistribution is done so that the active tissues get more blood flow. And hence this blood flow regulation plays a very important role. Second important role of blood flow regulation is thermoregulation. That means when the temperature of the body increases, like example, in summer, then what happens? There is vasodilation that occurs. Okay, peripheral vasodilation. So that large amount of heat loss will be done and the body temperature will be maintained normal. Similarly, when the body temperature is going to decrease or become less than normal, for example, in winter, there is peripheral vasoconstriction so that the blood flow decreases. So that what happens? The peripheral blood flow decreases, so the heat loss decreases and hence the body temperature is again maintained constant. Okay. Now in emergencies, for example, there is a road traffic accident, lot of blood loss has been taken place. Okay. In such situations also, the blood flow is regulated in such a manner that all the vital organs like the brain, kidney, liver, okay, heart, all these are given the normal blood supply. Okay, their blood supply is not hampered. So in such conditions, the main function that is played by the cardiovascular system is to regulate the blood flow. Okay, now how is this blood flow regulation done? The blood flow regulating mechanisms can be classified as local mechanisms, humoral mechanisms and neural mechanisms. What do you mean by local mechanisms? Local matlab jo active tissue hai, उसके सराउंडिंग में कुछ चेंजेस आते हैं जिसकी वजह से वो खुद का ब्लड फ्लो चेंज कर सकता है. लाइक फॉर एग्जाम्पल, आई टोल्ड यू दैट व्हेन आई एम डूइंग एक्सरसाइज से ओनली विथ माय राइट हैंड. ओके, सो देयर विल बी वेरियस लोकल चेंजेस दैट विल बी हैपनिंग नियर द स्केलेटल मसल cells of my right hand, which will result into increase in blood flow to that hand because that hand is active at that moment. So that is called as local mechanism. What is humoral mechanisms? There are various substances which are released, okay, in the body. Their action is systemic. Systemic means the action is seen all throughout the body. Okay, but it is released into the blood, resulting into vasoconstriction and vasodilation, which regulates the blood flow. And the third is the neural mechanism. Okay, sorry. Now, first we will see the local mechanisms. The local mechanisms can be classified into acute and long term. Acutely, like I said, that I have started exercising with my right hand. So it is an acute phenomenon which I have started. Okay, so whenever there is an acute increase in blood supply requirement or blood flow requirement, these mechanisms play an important role. The mechanisms can be classified further into metabolic mechanisms and special metabolic mechanisms. Now, what do you mean by metabolic mechanisms? First is vasodilator theory. What do you mean by vasodilator theory? Now, like I told you, if I'm exercising with my right hand, the skeletal muscle cells of my right hand are working more. They are active at that moment. So what happens is they are working more. And hence, in the surrounding, the amount of carbon dioxide that will be produced in the vicinity of these skeletal muscle cells will be more because their metabolic rate has increased. Similarly, lactic acid production, which is a byproduct, that will be also increased because it is a metabolic byproduct. That means H plus is increasing. Now there will be large amount of K plus, that is potassium, also will increase in the vicinity. Lot of ATP is utilized by the skeletal muscle. So ATP will be broken down into adenosine plus ATP degradation products. Now all these substances which are started accumulating in the vicinity of the active tissue, That is what the potassium ions, the hydrogen ions, the carbon dioxide, then the adenosine, the ATP degradation products, all these act as vasodilators. What will they do? They will cause the relaxation of the precapillary sphincter, relaxation of the arterioles, relaxation of the met arterioles that are supplying that particular tissue which is active. And therefore, there will be vasodilation. Once the vasodilation will occur, what will happen? The blood flow to this active tissue will automatically increase. So the first theory that locally regulates the blood flow to the active tissue in acute circumstances is vasodilator theory. The second is oxygen or nutrient lag theory. Now, what does that mean? Now, as I told you, my right hand skeletal muscle is working, is active at this moment. So its oxygen requirement has increased because the metabolic rate has increased. So oxygen and the nutrients like the amino acids, the fatty acids that are required for metabolism to produce ATP, all these requirements are increased. So finally, what happens, because the metabolic rate has increased, a stage comes when, because of the active tissues in the vicinity, there will be a lack of oxygen because the requirement has increased. There will be lack of nutrients like vitamins, lack of carbohydrates, glucose, or lack of amino acids in the vicinity. Why? Because the requirement has increased. And this in turn will result into decrease in the production of ATP. And if this, that is decrease in oxygen, decrease in the nutrients, and decrease in the ATP together will again result into vasodilation of the atrioles, met arterioles, and the capillary sphincters, again causing vasodilation and increase in blood supply to the active tissue. Okay. Now the second is special metabolic control. Now what is special metabolic control? In that comes two main theories, that is reactive hyperemia and active hyperemia. What do you mean by reactive hyperemia? Suppose I tie a very, a band, okay, across my hand. Okay, such that the blood flow to my fingers stop. Okay, so if there is an obstruction which is resulting into lack of blood supply to a tissue or an organ, then the hyperemia, the increase in the blood flow after the obstruction has been relieved, will be proportionately more as compared to the duration for which the obstruction was there. Okay, that is called as reactive hyperemia. In reaction to the loss of blood flow due to obstruction, what happens? The blood flow then increases many more times for the same amount of time as the obstruction was to combat with the lack of oxygen, lack of nutrients, and the accumulation of metabolic waste products. That is called as reactive hyperemia. Okay. Now, what is active hyperemia? Active hyperemia means, suppose, for example, there is any tissue which is working for a very long time. Okay. And then, I'll give you active hyperemia means, suppose you start exercising today, okay, and you do it regularly for 3 to 4 days continuously, the same set of dumbbells with your right hand. So finally, what happens? The blood supply to that right hand will increase due to the increase in activity of your right hand. That is called as active hyperemia. Okay, so what are the long-term? Long-term means long-term, there is an increased requirement of oxygen, nutrients, or blood flow to that particular organ or tissue. Okay, for example, the people who live in high altitude, they are living at high altitude. So what happens? The continuous requirement of blood flow to the various tissues is more. Why? Because the oxygen, the partial pressure of oxygen there is less. So the blood flow needs to be increased to the tissues. Hence, if you see, their tissues will be more vascular as compared to our tissues. So there is change in tissue vascularity if there is a long-term increased blood flow requirement to a tissue. Development of collateral circulation. Now, what is development of collateral circulation? See, everybody does not suffer from MI, right? But as your age increases, there are bound to be obstructions. This is an example. There are bound to be obstructions or atherosclerotic plaques in the coronary circulation, which will stop the blood flow to the heart to a particular area. But what happens if your vascular endothelium, the vascular endothelial growth factors, all these growth factors become favorable enough, then collaterals will branch out from the area above the obstruction to the area below the obstruction, and then there will be an alternate pathway for the blood flow, and therefore the blood flow will then reach to the area, okay, which was going to be ischemic because of the obstruction. That is called as development of collateral circulation. This also is directly proportional to the requirement of the tissue, okay, blood flow requirement of the tissue. So what we have seen, that blood flow regulation is very important. One, to maintain the blood supply to the vital organs during crisis. Second, so that thermoregulation is maintained. And third, so that the redistribution of the blood flow can be done to the active tissues whenever required. Now, how are the blood flow regulated? How is the blood flow regulated? By three mechanisms: local mechanism, humoral mechanism, and neural mechanism. Local mechanisms are again classified into acute and long term. If there is acute increase in the requirement of blood flow, then the theories that guide the regulatory mechanisms are vasodilator theory, oxygen or nutrient lack theory, and reactive hyperemia, active hyperemia. If there is long term increase in the requirement of the blood flow, or the blood flow needs to be regulated for a longer time, then it results into, then it is causing an increase in the tissue vascularity altogether, plus there may be collateral developments that may take place. The next mechanism is humoral mechanism. A humoral mechanism means there are various vasodilators and vasoconstrictors which will be released locally in the area where the blood flow regulation needs to be increased or decreased as per the requirement. The local vasodilators are decreased oxygen, decreased blood pH, that means H+, increased carbon dioxide, increased blood body temperature, increased potassium ions, increased lactic acid accumulation, and adenosine. Local vasoconstrictors are serotonin and decreased body temperature. Okay, now this autoregulatory mechanism, that is the local autoregulatory mechanism, is very well developed in some tissues like heart, brain, kidney, and skeletal muscles. Okay, and this autoregulation for the blood flow is guided by two main theories, that is myogenic theory and metabolic theory. Metabolic theory we have already seen. What is myogenic theory? Myogenic theory says that whenever there is increase in arterial blood pressure to a particular organ, what will, or a tissue, that means what is increased? The perfusion pressure is increased. Arterial blood pressure is increased. So the arterial wall is stretched. Once the arterial wall is stretched, it is nothing but the smooth muscles, right, that are stretched. So this increase, this will result into opening of voltage-gated calcium channels once the stretch receptors are also stretched in the smooth muscles. The opening of the calcium channels will result into large amount of influx of calcium into the smooth muscles, resulting into their increased contraction of the smooth muscles. Once the smooth muscle contracts, what will happen? There will be vasoconstriction and the blood flow will be brought to normal. We had started with increased blood pressure due to increased perfusion pressure, means increased blood flow. Right? So whenever there is increase in blood flow due to increased perfusion pressure, it, resulting into increased arterial blood pressure. There will be stretching of the arterial walls. In turn, there will be stretching of the stretch receptors, which will cause the opening of the voltage-gated calcium channels in the smooth muscles. So calcium influx will start, which will cause the contraction of the smooth muscles of the vessels, resulting into vasoconstriction. And therefore, finally, the blood flow will be brought to normal. So this is called as myogenic theory. Okay. Now, as I told you, whenever there is a long-term increased requirement of oxygen and nutrients, then there is altogether change in the tissue vascularity that is formed. That is, there is increase in tissue vascularity. And for that, whatever is required is vascular endothelial growth factor, fibroblast growth factor, and platelet-derived growth factor. Okay. Now, how does this vascularity increase? Whatever are the vessels, a point pe वहां का एंडोथीलियम और उसका बेसमेंट मेम्ब्रेन को डिसॉल्व किया जाता है, दैट इज डिसोल्यूशन टेक्स प्लेस. एंड हु हेल्प्स इन द डिसोल्यूशन? द स्टेरॉइड हार्मोन्स, द एंजियोस्टैटिन एंड द एंडोस्टैटिन. दिस कॉजेस द फ्रैगमेंटेशन ऑफ द endothelium, the collagen, the fibrinogen, and finally, with the help of these growth factors, then there is massive increase in the production of the endothelial cells, the basement membranes, and a cord is formed. This cord then goes on increasing in length and finally causing a new vessel to be developed or a branch to be developed from the original vessel, increasing the vascularity of the tissue. Development of collaterals, we have already discussed. Okay. Now, humoral control. Now, when I say humoral control means, initially what we discussed was the local. Humoral means these are the substances which are released in the blood, which results into a systemic vasoconstrictor effect. Systemic means all throughout the circulatory system, there will be a vasoconstrictor effect, or all throughout the circulatory system, there will be a vasodilator effect. What are the vasodilators? The vasodilators are bradykinin, histamine, nitric oxide. Nitric oxide is a potent vasodilator. Okay, bradykinin and histamine are vasodilators, as well as they increase the capillary permeability and play an important role during the process of inflammation. So the major vasodilators are bradykinin, histamine, and nitric oxide. The major vasoconstrictors are norepinephrine, epinephrine, angiotensin II, vasopressin, and endothelin. Okay, so we will see one by one. Now, who releases nitric oxide? Remember, nitric oxide is released by the endothelial cells. Whenever acetylcholine, BIP, okay, such substances or bradykinin, they come and occupy the receptors that are present on the endothelial cells, it causes the activation of the second messenger system to stimulate the nitric oxide synthesis from arginine. And hence, nitric oxide is produced. This nitric oxide is produced by the endothelial cells. The nitric oxide is then released in the vicinity of the smooth muscle cells. It enters the smooth muscle cells, stimulates the guanylyl cyclase, which converts GTP into cyclic GMP. Once the cyclic GMP is stimulated, it will cause a decrease in the intracellular calcium. That is, it will cause efflux of calcium and hence the muscles will relax. So remember, nitric oxide is released by the endothelium whenever there is increase in arterial blood pressure, because it causes a damage to the endothelium. Whenever there is endothelial damage, the endothelium will release the nitric oxide. Endothelium also releases a vasoconstrictor, which is called as endothelin, which we'll see further. But this nitric oxide production is enhanced by acetylcholine VIP. Okay. And this is the mechanism of action. What does it cause? It causes relaxation of the vascular smooth muscles, relaxation of the GIT smooth muscles, vasodilation and engorgement of corpora cavernosa for penile erection. In short, it causes the relaxation of all the smooth muscles of the vessels and the GIT smooth muscles. It is important for cytotoxic activity of the macrophages. And who enhances the nitric oxide production? Mainly the acetylcholine, the bradykinin, and the VIP. as I told you, whenever there is stress to the endothelium due to increased blood pressure, the nitric oxide production is stimulated. Okay, now nitric oxide is a potent vasodilator. The other vasodilators are bradykinin and histamine. Okay, which we will see later. The other potent vasoconstrictor is epinephrine and norepinephrine. Okay, now epinephrine acts on both alpha adrenergic receptors and beta adrenergic receptors. But norepinephrine, it acts only on beta adrenergic receptors. This is also asked as an MCQ. Epinephrine acts on alpha adrenergic as well as beta adrenergic receptors, whereas norepinephrine acts only on beta adrenergic receptors. When alpha adrenergic receptors are stimulated, remember alpha is again of two types, alpha 1 and alpha 2. Alpha 1 receptors, whenever the epinephrine acts on alpha 1 receptors, it causes potent vasoconstriction. It is a potent vasoconstrictor. Whereas in the intestinal smooth muscles, it causes relaxation. Okay. The next point to keep in mind is alpha 2 receptors. The alpha 2 receptors, whenever stimulated, it causes vasoconstriction plus platelet aggregation. The potent effect is what? Vasoconstriction plus platelet aggregation. Now, I told you that epinephrine, it acts on both alpha as well as beta. But if you see beta is causing smooth muscle relaxation. Beta 2 causes smooth muscle relaxation. That means epinephrine is causing smooth muscle relaxation via beta 2 and smooth muscle constriction via acting on alpha receptors. But the action of alpha is more potent than beta, and therefore it causes increase in blood pressure or it causes potent vasoconstriction. But at the same time, norepinephrine, it acts only on beta receptors. So beta pe act hone pe kya karta hai? Beta 1 receptor stimulate hone pe tachycardia hota hai. Or beta 2, whenever it is stimulated, it will cause the bronchodilation and smooth muscle relaxation and sphincter constriction. Okay, so whenever beta is stimulated, there will be increase in heart rate, but the vasoconstrictor effect will not be present. Vasoconstrictor effect is present only when epinephrine acts on alpha receptors. Okay. The next is angiotensin 2. Angiotensin 2 is also a potent vasoconstrictor. Whenever the blood pressure decreases, that is hypotension, the blood supply to the kidney decreases. Kidney starts undergoing ischemia. Okay. Now, do you know JG apparatus in the kidney? Juxtaglomerular apparatus? Yes, students, do you know about the juxtaglomerular apparatus? Okay, it will be taught to you in kidney. Whenever blood supply to the kidney decreases because of decrease in blood pressure, what happens is the JG apparatus is stimulated. It causes the JG cells to produce a substance which is called as renin. This renin acts on angiotensinogen. What is angiotensinogen? It is a plasma protein which is released by the liver. So renin will act on angiotensinogen, which is a plasma protein secreted by liver, and will convert it into angiotensin 1. Angiotensin 1 will be converted to angiotensin 2 in the presence of angiotensin converting enzymes. This enzyme is mainly found in the lung. Also found to some extent in the kidney. This angiotensin 2 is a potent vasoconstrictor. It causes vasoconstriction, okay, and increase in blood pressure. Apart from this, angiotensin 2 stimulates the adrenal cortex to produce aldosterone. What does aldosterone do? It causes sodium and water retention. So more and more sodium water retention, blood pressure will again start increasing. We had started with hypotension, right? So blood pressure will start increasing with sodium water retention. Apart from this, angiotensin 2 also stimulates the pituitary to the anti-diuretic hormone is what? Anti-diuresis means it causes sodium water retention. So angiotensin 2, it will stimulate the pituitary. Which pituitary? Posterior pituitary, to produce more and more ADH so that sodium water retention can take place and blood pressure can be brought back to normal. Apart from this, angiotensin 2 also stimulates the thirst center in the hypothalamus to increase the blood volume so that the blood pressure can be increased. Okay, so this is one more humoral vasoconstrictor, that is angiotensin 2. The third is vasopressin. As the name suggests, vaso means vessels, pressin means pressor. Okay, so it is also a potent vasoconstrictor. This is the other name of antidiuretic hormone. Whenever there is hyperosmolarity or increase in arterial blood pressure, hypothalamus stimulates the posterior pituitary to produce vasopressin. Vasopressin has two receptors, V1 and V2. V1 is present on the blood vessels. Whenever vasopressin acts on the V1 receptors, which are present on the blood vessels, it causes vasoconstriction and hence increased resistance, so increased arterial pressure. Whenever vasopressin acts on V2 receptors, which are present in the kidney, it causes sodium water retention. Mainly it causes water retention by increasing the reabsorption of water by inducing aquaporins in the CT cells, that is collecting tubules of the kidney, and hence there will be increased blood volume, so increase in arterial pressure. Okay, this is endothelin 1. As I told you, whenever blood pressure increases, whenever there is endothelial disruption or endothelial injury, apart from nitric oxide, the endothelium also produces a substance which is called as endothelin. And this endothelin is a potent vasoconstrictor. It is a potent vasoconstrictor. Next is bradykinin, which is a vasodilator. The initial vasodilator that we discussed was nitric oxide. Okay, so bradykinin is produced from high molecular weight kininogen. Okay, there is one more bradykinin which is called as lysyl, L-Y-S-I-L. It is lysyl bradykinin, which is also produced from low molecular weight kininogen. Okay, in the tissues, if it is produced, then it becomes lysyl bradykinin. If it is produced in the plasma, it is called as bradykinin. What is the main role of this? As I told you, it increases vascular permeability, it causes vasodilation, plays an important role in inflammation, and hence acts as a migrator for the leukocytes. That means it also helps in chemotaxis, but it causes bronchoconstriction. Bradykinin causes bronchoconstriction and uterine contraction. Okay, but bradykinin is a potent vasodilator and increases the capillary permeability. Hence, plays an important role in inflammation. The next is histamine. Histamine is released mainly by the mast cells in the tissues and the basophils in the blood. This histamine also causes increase in vasodilation and capillary permeability and hence plays an important role in inflammation. So what have we seen up till now? If you see the initial slides we were discussing, just a small recap. Okay, so we were discussing the blood flow regulatory mechanisms. In that we saw that there are three main mechanisms: the local mechanism, the humoral mechanism, and the neural mechanism. The local mechanisms, are if there is acute increase in the requirement due to increase in activity, the theory that regulates the blood flow is vasodilator theory and oxygen nutrient lack theory, reactive hyperemia, active hyperemia. If there is a long-term increase in blood flow requirement, then there is complete change in the tissue vascularity that takes place, or there is development of collateral circulation. This is a local mechanism which is happening at the in the vicinity of the tissue which is active and whose requirement has increased. Depending on whether it is an acute increase in requirement or it is a long-term or a persistent increase in the requirement. Next is humoral mechanisms are by release of various vasoconstrictors and vasodilators. What were the various vasoconstrictors that we saw? Epinephrine, norepinephrine, endothelin. Okay, main vasoconstrictors that you need to know are epinephrine, norepinephrine, and endothelin. Vasopressin, which acts on V1 and V2 receptors, and angiotensin 2. Angiotensin 2 has various mechanisms. It is renin-angiotensin-aldosterone pathway, stimulation of thirst, stimulation of adrenal cortex to release aldosterone to cause sodium water retention, stimulation of the pituitary to cause ADH release so that sodium water retention takes place and blood pressure increases. Okay. Vasodilators, potent vasodilators released by endothelium itself is nitric oxide. It is produced by the endothelial cells. It enters into the smooth muscles and it decreases the calcium influx, resulting into smooth muscle relaxation, and therefore the vessels undergo relaxation, and hence it acts as a vasodilator. So nitric oxide is a potent vasodilator. Other vasodilators are bradykinin and histamine, but the main role of bradykinin and histamine is mainly in inflammation. Okay. Now the third by which the blood flow is regulated is called as the neural mechanism, which is very important mechanism. The neural mechanism shows its action mainly through the autonomic nervous system. The autonomic nervous system is mainly made up of parasympathetic nerves and sympathetic nerves, right? Skeletal muscles are supplied by which nerves? See, there are three types of muscles: skeletal muscles, smooth muscles, and cardiac muscles. The skeletal muscles, they are supplied by somatic nerves. Okay. The smooth muscles and the cardiac muscles, they are mainly supplied by the autonomic nervous system. The autonomic nervous system consists of two types of nerves: parasympathetic nerve and sympathetic nerve. Okay. Parasympathetic nerve and sympathetic nerve. This autonomic nervous system nerves, they come from the spinal cord. The nerves that come from the intermediolateral horn of the spinal cord, okay, from the thoracolumbar region, are all sympathetic nerves. And the nerves that come from the craniosacral outflow of the spinal cord, they are all the parasympathetic nerves. Okay, so jo bhi nerves स्पाइनल कॉर्ड में से आ रहे हैं सोमैटिक को छोड़ के, ये ऑटोनॉमिक नर्व्स कहां से आते हैं? इंटरमीडियोलैटरल हॉर्न से आते हैं. ओके, इफ दे आर कमिंग आउट फ्रॉम द थोराकोलंबर रीजन, दे आर ऑल सिंपैथेटिक नर्व्स. इफ दे आर कमिंग आउट फ्रॉम द क्रेनियोसैक्रल, क्रेनियल एंड द सैक्रल पार्ट ऑफ द स्पाइनल कॉर्ड, देन दे आर ऑल द पैरासिंपैथेटिक नर्व्स. पैरासिंपैथेटिक नर्व्स हैव न्यूरोट्रांसमीटर एज एसिटाइलकोलीन, and sympathetic nerves have the neurotransmitter as epinephrine or norepinephrine. Okay, so this is the autonomic nervous system through which the neural mechanisms, they regulate the blood flow. So the cardiac muscles are also supplied by the autonomic nervous system. So neural mechanism mainly regulates the pumping of the heart, it regulates the heart rate, and it regulates the distribution of blood flow to the various parts of the body by causing vasoconstriction or vasodilation. Whenever sympathetic nervous system is stimulated, it will cause vasoconstriction and increase in heart rate, increase in force of contraction of the heart. Whenever parasympathetic nervous system will be stimulated, it will cause vasodilation. It will cause decrease in heart rate and decrease in force of contraction of the heart. So how is this neural mechanism working? By redistribution of blood flow to different parts of the body by causing vasoconstriction or vasodilation, regulating the pumping activity of heart, either increasing or decreasing it based on the requirement. Sympathetic, if stimulated, will cause increase in pumping activity. Parasympathetic will cause decrease. And it also controls the arterial blood pressure because it is mainly regulating the vasoconstriction and vasodilation also. How is the blood pressure regulated? The blood pressure regulating mechanisms can be classified into short-term, long-term, and intermediate-term. Short-term mechanisms. It is always a part of the body that the blood pressure is always maintained normal. It is called as autoregulatory mechanisms. There are various autoregulatory mechanisms in the body which always try to maintain the arterial blood pressure normal. As soon as there is any increase or decrease in the blood pressure, various mechanisms in the body come into action to bring it back to normal. The instant mechanism that will come into play are the baroreceptors, chemoreceptors, and CNS ischemic response, and hence they are called as short term. Means as soon as there is a sudden change in the blood pressure, these mechanisms will come into action, but their action lasts for a few seconds. The long term mechanism is mainly by the kidney control. They can control the blood pressure for nearly days, for nearly hours to days, whereas intermediate, they can regulate the blood flow and maintain it normal for a few minutes or hours. Okay. First, we will see mainly the baroreceptors. What are baroreceptors? Baroreceptors. Baro means pressure. Okay. And receptors means the sensory organ which is going to sense the change in the pressure. So these are nothing but stretch receptors which are present in the walls of the heart and the large vessel walls. They are nothing but the spray nerve endings. So whenever the blood pressure increases, okay, whenever the blood pressure increases, there is a stretch on the arterial wall. Whenever there is stretch, these are stretch receptors. So the baroreceptors are also stretched and hence they are stimulated. Where are these baroreceptors present? They are present in the walls of the arch of the aorta and in the carotid sinus just after the bifurcation, that is the division of the common carotid artery into internal and external carotid artery. So where are these baroreceptors present? They are present nearly in the walls of the ventricles, the atria, as well as the walls of the large arteries. Mainly they are present in the arch of the aorta as well as the carotid sinus walls. Okay, so whenever blood pressure increases, okay, the arterial wall will be stretched. So what will happen? The baroreceptors will be stimulated. Normally it is said that there is a continuous stimulation that goes from the baroreceptors. Okay, so as soon as there is stretch, what will happen? The number of impulses that is going from the baroreceptors will increase. And it will be interpreted that the blood pressure has increased. If the blood pressure goes on decreasing less than normal, to kya hota tha? Agar normally baroreceptor 4 se 5 impulses bhej raha tha, to wo impulses ka rate kam hone lagta hai. So automatically the brain senses that the blood pressure is decreasing and the necessary action is done. Okay, now the aortic arch receptors, the afferent means the nerve fibers which carry the sensation towards the brain. The afferent to the aortic arch receptors is vagus nerve, whereas the afferent to the carotid sinus receptors is the glossopharyngeal nerve, that is nerve 9. And where do they take the impulses to? They take it to the integrating center, which is the integrating center, the nucleus tractus solitarius, which is present in the medulla. Where is it present in the medulla? It is present bilaterally, both the sides of the brain. It is present in the medulla at the floor of the fourth ventricle, at the floor of the fourth ventricle in the nucleus tractus solitarius. सो बैरोसेप्टर्स कंटिन्यूस इम्पल्सिस देते हैं, जैसे ही ब्लड प्रेशर बढ़ता है दे आर स्ट्रेच, रेट ऑफ इम्पल्स डिस्चार्ज इंक्रीजेस, एज सून एज ब्लड प्रेशर डिक्रीजेस द रेट ऑफ डिस्चार्ज ऑफ इम्पल्सिस डिक्रीजेस, एंड वेयर इज दिस इम्पल्सिस टेकिंग गोइंग, इट इज इंटीग्रेटेड इन अ सेंटर विच इज कॉल्ड एज न्यूक्लियस ट्रैक्टस सॉलिटेरियस विच इज प्रेजेंट इन द मेड्यूला, एंड हु आर टेकिंग दीज द एफरेंट नर्व्स. From the aortic arch, it is taken by the vagus, and from the carotid, it is taken by the glossopharyngeal nerve. Okay, so in the medulla, there are two main areas. One is called as the pressor area, and the other is called as the depressor area. Now, the easy way to keep it in mind is pressor area is RVLM, and depressor area is CVLM. What is RVLM? Rostral ventrolateral medulla. ओके, रोस्ट्रल मींस ऊपर का वेंट्रोलैटरल मेड्यूला का ऊपर का पार्ट बिकम्स द प्रेशर एरिया, और वेंट्रोलैटरल मेड्यूला का कॉडल पार्ट, कॉडल मींस लोअर पार्ट, बिकम्स द डिप्रेसर एरिया. सो व्हेनेवर द प्रेशर एरिया इज स्टिम्युलेटेड, व्हाट डज इट कॉज? इट कॉजेस द स्टिम्युलेशन ऑफ द सिंपैथेटिक नर्वस सिस्टम, एंड देयरफॉर देयर इज आर्टेरियोलर कंस्ट्रिक्शन, वीनो कंस्ट्रिक्शन, इंक्रीज इन हार्ट रेट, इंक्रीज इन फोर्स ऑफ कॉन्ट्रैक्शन. व्हेनेवर द डिप्रेसर एरिया इज स्टिम्युलेटेड, दैट इज CVLM इज स्टिम्युलेटेड, इट इनहिबिट्स द प्रेशर एरिया. CVLM जब स्टिम्युलेट होता है तो वो RVLM को इनहिबिट करता है, इसलिए उसके सारे एक्शंस इसके उल्टे हैं, दैट इज आर्टेरियोलर डायलेशन, वीनो डायलेशन, डिक्रीज इन हार्ट रेट एंड डिक्रीज इन फोर्स ऑफ कॉन्ट्रैक्शन. नाउ अपार्ट फ्रॉम दीज टू एरियाज देयर इज वन मोर एरिया व्हिच इज कॉल्ड एज मेड्युलरी पैरासिंपैथेटिक एरिया, व्हिच इज आल्सो कॉल्ड एज द कार्डियो इनहिबिटरी एरिया, व्हिच इज प्रेजेंट इन न्यूक्लियस एम्बिगस. The efferent is vagus, and as we know, vagus is inhibitory to the heart, and it causes vasodilation. Why? Because it is parasympathetic nerve, and the neurotransmitter is acetylcholine. It decreases the heart rate, decreases the force of contraction, and also causes vasodilation. So, what is the overall mechanism? If you sum up the mechanism, normally impulses come from the baroreceptors via vagus and glossopharyngeal nerves to the integrating center, that is nucleus tractus solitarius. If the blood pressure increases, the number of impulses that will be produced by the baroreceptors will increase, because baroreceptors will be stimulated, and that will go to the nucleus tractus solitarius. So nucleus tractus solitarius will identify that the blood pressure has increased. तो वो क्या करेगा? It will stimulate CVLM, which is the depressor area. What is the action of CVLM? CVLM will inhibit the RVLM, and therefore sympathetic outflow will be decreased. Once the sympathetic outflow is decreased, what will happen? Vasodilation will take place. Heart rate will decrease, right? And force of contraction will decrease. On the other hand, the nucleus tractus solitarius will stimulate nucleus ambiguous also. What is nucleus ambiguous? The medullary parasympathetic area or cardiovagal output. So what it will do? It will decrease the heart rate and decrease the cardiac output, and thus it will bring the blood pressure back to normal. This is when blood pressure increases. Now suppose blood pressure decreases. So what happens? The number of impulses that the baroreceptor was sending per minute will decrease. The impulses reaching the nucleus tractus solitarius will be less. So nucleus tractus solitarius will interpret that the blood pressure has decreased. So what it will do? It will directly stimulate the RVLM and will cause the stimulation of the sympathetic outflow and will cause an increase in the force of contraction of the heart, the rate of heart, and will cause vasoconstriction, and it will inhibit CVLM. Okay, and it will inhibit CVLM, because CVLM has an inhibitory action on RVLM, and we have to stimulate RVLM to increase the blood pressure. Okay, so we know what are the afferent nerves: vagus nerve and glossopharyngeal nerve. What are the efferent nerves? The sympathetic supply is by T1 to L2. I told you they are thoracolumbar in origin. So it is T1 to L2, and it causes increase in heart rate, increase in conduction of impulse, increase in excitability, increase in force of contraction of the heart. Plus, it causes vasoconstriction, so there will be increase in blood pressure. It will cause venoconstriction, so there will be increase in venous return, and hence there will be increase in cardiac output. Parasympathetic nerve supply is by vagus. Vagus is inhibitory to heart, so decreases heart rate, decrease in conduction of impulse, decrease in excitability, and the force of contraction. Okay. Now, apart from the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system, there is one more system which is called a sympathetic vasodilator system. Now, these are present in the skeletal muscles only. Okay, you must have seen old Bollywood movies. Okay, उसमें माँ का character रहता था ना, तो उसको कभी भी कोई भी bad news मिला कि वो लगे चक्कर आके गिर जाती थी. Yes or no? That means that is called as vasovagal syncope. And it is because of intense emotional disturbances. And what is the cause of it? It is the sympathetic vasodilator system. Whenever there is stress, what happens? Sympathetic nervous system is stimulated so that there will be increase in heart rate, increase in blood pressure. But whenever this sympathetic nervous system is stimulated, there is sympathetic vasodilator system. Means there are vasodilators which are present in the skeletal muscles. They will be also stimulated. So there will be vasodilation which take place in this skeletal muscle. So blood will be diverted more towards the skeletal muscle when there is intense stress due to emotions. And that will result into decrease in blood supply to the brain, resulting into what? A syncope. Syncope matlab chakkar aake gir jana. And that is called as vasovagal syncope. Okay? Which happens during intense emotional disturbances. It is mainly to increase the blood flow during exercise. Because exercise ke time pe bhi sympathetic stimulation hota hai. There is sympathetic vasodilator system that is also stimulated and blood is diverted more to the skeletal muscles. But when there is intense emotional disturbances, the same phenomenon occurs. But at this time, what happens? It is so intense that the blood supply to the brain decreases and therefore there is syncopal attack. Okay. What is the role of the higher centers? The cerebral cortex is the area where the thought process initiates, and hence even the thought process can result into the increase in blood pressure, increase in heart rate or vasoconstriction. How? For example, sexual excitement. Any thought that brings about sexual excitement can also cause tachycardia and hypertension. So they are related to emotions but resulting into the regulation of blood pressure, okay, and the heart rate. Sudden emotional shock resulting into bradycardia and fainting, and flight and fight response. Whenever there is any adverse condition, okay, you will either try to fly away from it or you will try to fight. At that time, the sympathetic nervous system is stimulated, and hence again there will be increase in heart rate, increase in blood pressure. Now that is mere on the thought process. Okay. Hypothalamus. Hypothalamus plays an important role in temperature regulation and emotional stress. So hypothalamus also plays an important role in regulation of blood pressure as well as blood flow. Reticular substance. Reticular substance plays an important role in pain. There are two types of pain. One is superficial pain, which is the sharp pain, and one is vesicular pain, which comes from the viscera from inside. Visceral pain and sharp pain. Whenever there is visceral pain, it results into fainting, nausea, and decrease in blood pressure. Whenever there is superficial pain, like pin prick, okay, or there is a cut, then it will result into increase in heart rate and increase in blood pressure. Okay. Now, always remember that these baroreceptors are not stimulated until and unless the blood pressure, okay, is above 60 mmHg. I told you, normal blood pressure range from 70 to 175 mmHg, regular impulses grow from the baroreceptors. When the blood pressure goes above 175, then the rate of impulses go on increasing further. And it is maximum at 180 mmHg. when these baroreceptor or when the blood pressure goes below 60 mmHg, the baroreceptor stops sending impulses at all. Okay, and then the nucleus tractus solitarius interprets the changes and does the necessary stimulation of sympathetic or the parasympathetic nervous system. Okay, so what are chemoreceptors for control of arterial pressure? Chemoreceptors are the same like that of the respiratory center. Whenever there is increase in carbon dioxide, increase in H plus or decrease in oxygen, these chemoreceptors in the medulla oblongata, they are stimulated. Now this will take place when there is stagnation of blood. There is stagnation of blood, and therefore there is increase in carbon dioxide, decrease in oxygen, increase in H plus. That means blood pressure has decreased. So what will the nucleus tractus solitarius do? It will stimulate the vasomotor center, that is the pressor area, to stimulate the sympathetic nervous system to increase the heart rate, increase the force of contraction, and cause vasoconstriction to cause increase in blood pressure. Whenever opposite is the scenario, it will cause the stimulation of the parasympathetic nervous system. So whenever there is decrease in blood pressure, there is decrease in blood flow resulting into stagnation. So oxygen delivery to tissues decreases, so carbon dioxide uptake from the tissues, carbon dioxide starts accumulating, and therefore there is decreased carbon dioxide uptake from the tissues, and therefore the chemoreceptors are stimulated, which stimulates the medullary VMC, that is vasomotor center, that is the pressor area, causing the stimulation of the sympathetic nervous system, and the blood pressure is brought back to normal. Okay, chemoreceptors operation does not act. Okay, matlab blood pressure, when it decreases to less than 80 mmHg, only after that the chemoreceptors start showing it action. Jab blood pressure 80 mmHg ke niche chala jata hai, tabhi chemoreceptors start showing its action. Okay, now there is one more response which is called as CNS ischemic response, which is a direct effect on vasomotor center. Now what is that? Whenever blood pressure decreases, blood flow also decreases to the brain. That means blood flow to the vasomotor center also decreases. That means there will be decrease in oxygen and increase in carbon dioxide in the vasomotor center itself. That means the pressor area itself. And whenever this happens, that means there is ischemia to the vasomotor center. The vasomotor center interprets that the blood pressure has decreased too much. So what it causes? It causes massive vasoconstriction by causing massive stimulation of the sympathetic nervous system. So in the periphery of the body, all the vessels undergo vasoconstriction and all the blood is diverted to the brain. And hence it is called a CNS ischemic response. It is the direct ischemic response to the vasomotor center. So there will be massive sympathetic stimulation resulting into vasoconstriction, and blood pressure will be brought back to the normal. At the same time, there will be vasodilation that will take place in the vasomotor center because of the local mechanisms, and all of the blood will be diverted to the brain and will cause the release of CNS ischemia. Okay, this is also called as the last ditch response. If this response fails, then the person is dead, because this response, it acts only when the blood pressure falls below 50 mmHg. This is the last response to which the body goes to when there is no other alternative left. And even after that, if this response is not able to bring the blood pressure back to normal, then the patient succumbs. Hence it is called as the last ditch response. So cerebral ischemic response is the last ditch response. Now, there is one more mechanism which is called as Cushing's reaction. Cushing's reaction is nothing but a special type of CNS ischemic response. That means, see, there is the skull. In the skull, there is cerebrospinal fluid which is present in the, and then there is the brain. Or brain ke surface pe vessels rehte. So agar CSF ka pressure badhta hai, तो क्या होगा? इट विल कॉज प्रेशर ऑन द ब्रेन, दैट मींस वेसल्स ऑफ द ब्रेन, एंड द वेसल्स विल गेट कंप्रेस्ड, है ना? CSF का प्रेशर बढ़ा तो इट विल कंप्रेस द ब्रेन, बट ब्रेन के सरफेस पे वेसल्स है तो वेसल्स विल बिकम कंप्रेस्ड. Hence, the blood supply to the brain will decrease because vessels are getting compressed. So, whenever there is increase in pressure in the cerebrospinal fluid, that is increase in the intracranial tension, the whole brain and the arteries in the brain, they undergo compression. So, blood supply to the brain is stopped. And when this blood supply is stopped, what will the vasomotor center detect? There is decreased blood flow to the vasomotor center. There is vasomotor center ischemia. So what it will do, it will stimulate the CNS ischemic response, massive vasoconstriction all throughout the body, and there will be increase in pressure, right? This will relieve the CNS ischemia. This will relieve the CNS ischemia. This reflex is called as Cushing's reaction. But because of this, what happens? There is bradycardia associated with hypertension. Okay, so whenever there is hypertension with bradycardia, it is a sign of increased intracranial pressure. How? As I told you, massive vasoconstriction ho jata hai, sara blood brain ki taraf flow hone lagta hai, and hence it is CNS ischemic response. Now, because there is massive vasoconstriction, what will the baroreceptor sense in the periphery, that is in the arch of the aorta and the carotid artery? That blood pressure has increased. So what it will do? Through the baroreceptor reflex, there will be stimulation of the CVLM to decrease the sympathetic nervous system. But hypertension is massive because of CNS ischemic response. What it can only do is it will decrease the heart rate. So whenever there is hypertension with bradycardia, it is a sign of increased intracranial pressure. Bradycardia is the response of baroreceptors, and hypertension is because of CNS ischemic response. Okay, what is Bezold-Jerish reflex? There are some drugs. Yes.
वो Cushing effect वाला बताइए ना फिर से मैम.
हाँ, Cushing effect. Okay, so Cushing effect में क्या होता है? You just imagine the skull. Skull के अंदर there is a layer of cerebrospinal fluid which keeps the skull, which keeps the brain in a buoyancy mechanism, right? फिर आता है brain, और brain के surface पे होता है vessels. Right? So, अगर CSF का प्रेशर इंक्रीज होता है तो वॉट इट विल डू, इट विल कंप्रेस ऑन द ब्रेन, बट ब्रेन के सर्फेस पे ही वेसल्स है तो वेसल्स भी कंप्रेस हो जाएंगे. उसकी वजह से क्या होगा? ब्लड सप्लाई टू द ब्रेन विल बी डिक्रीज्ड. सो व्हेन ब्लड सप्लाई इज डिक्रीज्ड, द ब्लड सप्लाई टू द वासोमोटर सेंटर विल ऑल्सो डिक्रीज. तो वासोमोटर सेंटर को क्या फील होगा? कि ब्लड प्रेशर इज डिक्रीजिंग. बट एक्चुअली इज इट डिक्रीजिंग? नो. It is the increase in intracranial pressure which is resulting into the ischemia of the vasomotor center. But vasomotor center ischemia mein ja raha hai, iske liye wo kya karta hai? Massive sympathetic stimulation kar deta hai in the peripheral circulation. The blood is then diverted to the brain. So now what happens? The brain is relieved of ischemia. Why? Because of the CNS ischemic response. Right? But at this time what has happened? पेरिफेरी में जहां पे मैसिव वैसोकंस्ट्रिक्शन हुआ है, पहले बीपी बड़ा नहीं था, द कॉज वाज इंक्रीज इन इंट्राक्रेनियल प्रेशर. ओके, बट वासोमोटर सेंटर वाज अंडरगोइंग इस्केमिया, सो इट कॉज्ड सीएनएस इस्केमिक रिस्पांस. नाउ व्हाट विल द बैरोरिसेप्टर्स इन द आयोटिक एंड द कैरोटिड बॉडीज फाइंड दैट द ब्लड प्रेशर हैज इंक्रीज टू मच. सो व्हाट इट विल डू? Through the nucleus tractus solitarius, it will try to inhibit the pressor area. वो प्रेशर एरिया को इनहिबिट करने की कोशिश करेगा, है ना? तो नॉर्मली जब प्रेशर एरिया इनहिबिट होता है तो क्या होता है? ब्लड प्रेशर विल डिक्रीज एंड हार्ट रेट विल डिक्रीज. बट हार्ट रेट तो डिक्रीज हो जाएगा, रिजल्टिंग इनटू ब्रेडिकार्डिया, पर बीपी नहीं डिक्रीज हो पाएगा. क्यों? क्योंकि बीपी वाज इंक्रीज्ड मैसिवली बाय सीएनएस सिस्टमिक रिस्पांस, एंड सीएनएस सिस्टमिक रिस्पांस इज मोर स्ट्रॉन्ग देन बैरोरिसेप्टर रिफ्लेक्स. सो हाइपरटेंशन विल बी मेंटेन्ड बट हार्ट रेट विल डिक्रीज बिकॉज ऑफ बैरोरिसेप्टर रिफ्लेक्स. एंड देयरफॉर व्हेनेवर देयर इज अ कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ हाइपरटेंशन विद ब्रेडिकार्डिया, remember it is always because of increased intracranial pressure. There is some pathology in the brain. Did you understand? Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, what is basalgeric reflex? It is a chemo reflex. Actually, there are some drugs like nicotine or serotonin, which when injected into the coronary arteries, it causes the left ventricular baroreceptors. Okay, left ventricular baroreceptors to get stimulated, and therefore the baroreceptors then send the impulse, which results into hypotension, bradycardia, and reflex apnea. Hypotension, bradycardia is whenever baroreceptors are stimulated, it causes an inhibition of the RVLM, right? But यहाँ पे stimulation किसकी वजह से हुआ है? Chemo, that is nicotine and serotonin. When are these released? Whenever there is massive myocardial infarction, large number of nicotine, serotonin is released by the degrading tissue. This then causes the baroreceptor stimulation, which in turn causes the hypotension, bradycardia, and hence most of the myocardial patients, they have persistent hypotension. This type of a reflex is called as basalgeric reflex. Okay, what is the role of skeletal muscles in BP regulation? Whenever there is abdominal compression reflex, okay, whenever hypotension is taking place, abdominal muscles are also contracted so that it will produce a pushing effect to the venous flow, and therefore venous return will increase, which will help in increasing the cardiac output and thereby increasing the blood pressure. What happens during exercise also? Exercise may, the calf muscles, they contract, they give a pushing effect to the venous blood flow, and therefore venous return increases, increasing the cardiac output, increasing the blood pressure. Okay, I think we will stop here. Okay, so we have discussed the local mechanisms, we have discussed the humoral mechanisms, and we have started with the neural mechanisms. In the neural, we saw the short term regulation, that is baroreceptor, chemoreceptor, and CNS ischemic response. Okay, so I shall end the meeting here. We will meet again at 12.